the last, with the last one next week. This is number 10 in it, and it was originally, if you remember, going to be 10, and then threw another one in there unexpectedly in the middle of it, and so and so it became a nice round 11. So there you go. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me come on, stand with me for the reading of God's word, starting at verse number 16. But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had designated. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some were doubtful. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age." Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word this evening. It's such a blessing to be able to hold the book that you wrote in our own hand and to be able to read its eternal words. And we ask you, Lord, just to make this word real to us. Real in a way that it affects us tomorrow and the day after that and the day after that. Words of life that stick to us. Would you open our hearts and our minds to hear what you would have for us this evening. And we'll thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. You can be seated this evening. Well, this is the Great Commission, obviously. The Great Commission. And so let me just start out with this. What's so great about the Great Commission? It's called, the title is literally the Great Commission. Jesus doesn't actually call it that, but if you've been in church any type of, in any length of time, you've heard the title or the designation, the Great Commission. And so let me ask you this, what's so great about the Great Commission here? And there's books written about this. I mean, there's all kinds, and we'll come back to that a little bit later. Here's what I think about when I read this passage, okay? Here's the essential question for me, and that is, why did Jesus make them walk a five-day trip to get this message? Good question, right? Yeah, have you ever thought about that? No. I mean, we all just assume it's the Great Commission, right? Well, no. There's a five-day trip involved in getting this Great Commission. Let me show you what I mean here, all right? And boom, here we go. There's two ways to get from Jerusalem to Galilee or from Galilee to Jerusalem. Notice they're going to Galilee, right? And that's exactly, but the 11 proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain. Where are they at? They're in Jerusalem for the crucifixion. And now you've had the resurrection. And so if you read before this, an angel appears to the women and says, "He's not here. See the place where he laid, but he's not here. Now go tell his disciples to go to Galilee and they'll see him." An angel is giving the message to the women, tell the disciples, get up and go, quit hiding and go to Galilee, and you're going to see him there. The word angel literally means sent one. He sent there with that particular message. Apparently, it's not good enough, because when you continue to read, listen to what it says. And verse number 3, "And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. The guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, 'Do not be afraid, for I know you're looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he is risen just as he said. Come and see with a place where he's lying. Go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he is going ahead of you into Galilee.'" Galilee, and there you will see him. Behold, I have told you. Kind of a formal ending to the angel's message, isn't it? Behold, I have told you. And so the women, it says in verse 8, and they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to report it to his disciples. Here's the weird part. Did Jesus forget he had just sent the angel? Because verse number 9 says, and behold, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Verse 10, then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and take word to my brethren to leave for Galilee, and there they will see me. The angel just said that. The angel literally just said that. It's not like he's got disobedient angels in heaven anymore. All of them are gone. Right? And so the angel comes, he delivers the message, he ends it with, hey, I told you what I was supposed to. And Jesus apparently says, I better make sure they understand. And meets them on the way to do what they were told and says, go tell them to go to Galilee, and I really mean it. All right, I mean it right now. Get on the road and go to Galilee. And so the disciples, this is my point in this whole thing. There has to be a really big reason for the Great Commission to be given in Galilee and not Jerusalem. Why? They're both in Jerusalem. All of them are in Jerusalem at the same time. He's already proved he could go into doors that were locked and just show up wherever he wanted to. He could have come to the room wherever they were hiding and said, I'm going to now give you the Great Commission. No, he wants them in a particular place to get this Great Commission, and it's going to involve a five-day walk. There's two roads to get from Jerusalem to Galilee. One is the Samaritan road, and one is the Jericho road, okay? Here's the problem. If you can see on my little map here, here's Capernaum. This is Jesus' headquarters in Galilee. Galilee comes down here. Nazareth is at the most southern part of Galilee here. But this is the Sea of Galilee here, and Capernaum is where the headquarters was. You had two choices. There's a road that comes straight down here to Jerusalem, straight down. See all these hills here? There's a road called the Samaritan Road. The problem with that road is there are Samaritans on that road. In between Galilee and Judea is Samaria. And if you're going to take that road, you have to go through Samaria. Now we know from Scripture that Jesus took both roads, all right? In his 3 years of ministry, he took both of these roads. He met the Samaritan at the well. Remember at Sychar, that's in Samaria. He specifically went that way for them. We also know that the disciples were not real keen on that idea. And in fact, in the book of Acts, Peter is really resistant to going to Gentiles or Samaritans or anywhere else. And so, given the fact that Jesus is not leading the way, which way do you think they took? Probably the Jericho road. And this is the way that it would go. They would come down Capernaum and they would take a turn here into the what's called the Jordan River Valley. They would follow the Jordan River all the way down here. The advantage to this, and there's advantages and disadvantages to both. One advantage to going the Samaritan route is it's at least a day shorter walking, all right? At least a full day, maybe a day and a half shorter walking. Disadvantage, so Samaritans don't like you because you don't like them, and they don't normally get along real well, and there's some danger on that road. Another advantage, though, is that you're up on top of the ridges of the mountain, and so you can see right over to this side. What's this? Oh, that's the Mediterranean Sea. Guess what comes off of that? Some nice cool breezes. And so as you're walking along the tops of all these ridges on the Samaritan Road, you get the benefit of all these cool breezes. But if you take the Jordan River Valley down this side, it's a much easier walk because you're in the valley. And you have a constant water supply called the Jordan River. Bad part is you wind up going further and further below sea level as you go until you get to Jericho right here. Right at the base here is where Herod built the Herodian palace as you start to climb up here. So here at Jericho, you're 800. You have gone from Capernaum to Jericho. At Jericho, you have descended down to 847 feet below sea level. There's not a breath to be had, and it is hot, hot, hot down there. So the whole time you're going down the Jordan River Valley, it's getting progressively hotter as you go deeper into the earth and below sea level. By the time you get to Jericho, then you're willing to brave the next part of the trip, which is the what's actually called the Jericho Road. It's 20 miles from Jericho. It comes just to here, and then it starts into the hill country like this, and here's Bethany, and then you get to Jerusalem. Here's the Mount of Olives up here. In this way, this is a dangerous route for these 16 miles from the foothills here. 16 miles from here at 847 feet below sea level up to Jerusalem. In 16 miles, you're going to go from almost 1,000 feet below sea level to almost 2,700 feet above sea level. In that 1,600 miles, that 16 miles, you're going to be a constant 3% grade going uphill. And it's very dangerous because there is nothing but barren wilderness and tiny, tiny little trails. Let me show you what I mean here. Oh, that's the elevation. If you're starting here at Herodian's palace here, at Herod's palace, way back here is Jerusalem. In other words, this is traditionally the Good Samaritan Inn. You've got the Ascent of Adullam here. It just winds and winds and winds back in there. And this is the place of the Good Samaritan parable, the Jericho Road. Remember how Jesus starts that out? Now a man was going down to Jericho. Why? Because he's coming from Jerusalem. He's coming from Jerusalem, so he's naturally going down for the next 16 miles. That's the road right there. These are some people from the University of Notre Dame, go Irish, and they're there on a pilgrimage and doing some archaeological studies. And that's exactly what it looks like here. So you can see immediately the problem with this. There's all kinds of crevices and caves, and it's a place where bandits would hang out. And you've got the wild animals. There's very little protection. There's no place to hide. You've got just ledges all the way around. And so you can really see the impact even then of the Good Samaritan parable, because if you've got a person who has been beaten by bandits, and they're on that road, and you're a Levite and you are a priest, you literally cannot miss them. They're on the road. You literally have to step over them to avoid them, which is the point of the Good Samaritan, right? He didn't walk over them. That's the road here. This is another how narrow that road is going through. Yeah, that's the whole 16 miles of the Jericho Road there. It's just 16 miles uphill. When the pilgrims would come, they would sing the last part of the Psalms of Ascent, because they're going up to Jerusalem. But again, you have this to your favor. This is the Wadi Gelt, and it's a water source of really cool, clear, sweet water the entire 16 miles, both coming down and coming up. It's down in the very bottom of that gorge that you see them winding by. And so here, people have done this for centuries. This is St. George's Monastery there on the side of the cliff. And the reason I bring it up is you can see down here, there's some green. That's that wadi that goes the entire way down there. I'll show you another picture. This is an older picture because the thing's been there since 420 A.D., and it was refigured then as a monastery in 500 A.D. It's been destroyed by the Persians and rebuilt by the Byzantines and on and on and on. It's got quite a history to it. And that's it today. They're just a beautiful, beautiful monastery. It's Greek Orthodox there. Here's the question. What are they talking about on the way? What are they doing on the way? They've got 5 days. They don't have a CD player. They don't have a radio. All they have is a message from the women. I saw an angel and I saw Jesus. You probably need to get backing. And both of them said the same thing. You need to be in Galilee. And there he's going to see you. So they go off. And they start heading to Galilee on that road. They're doing what people do. They're talking. My wife and I, when we travel, it is not unusual for us when we're on vacation to go the entire 2.5, 3 weeks and never turn on the radio. In fact, the first time we did that, we didn't even realize we did that. I was turning into our home in Pollocksville when I suddenly realized we haven't had the radio on in over 2 weeks just because we were doing this thing couples do called talking the whole time with each other. And we love doing that. And so it's a natural thing. And that's exactly what they're doing. Can you imagine the conversation they're having going back up to Galilee for 5 days? Now they know that the Lord has been risen from the dead, that he is indeed who he said he is. I imagine on that Jericho road, somebody's remembering the parable of the Good Samaritan and how they're supposed to act, and they're rehashing all of these stories of the last 3 years because they've got 5 days of travel up, at least going up to Galilee to this mountain. I call it the mountain with no name because we don't know what mountain it is up there. It's Mount No Name. Is what it is. It's the only mountain we're studying where we don't know the name of the mountain, but they're going to it. It's a place that they knew well. They knew what mountain to go to. It's one that they have been to several times, that they were in the habit of going to. And so my personal belief, although scripture doesn't tell us, is it's right outside of Capernaum. We've seen before where Jesus went up there to pray, and it was a normal thing for them to go up into the hills. Directly on the backside of Capernaum is the hills, is the mountains there, and Jesus would go up. I showed you those on other sides then, and I think that's where they're going. Now, have you heard this thing about the Great Commission, of the three commands of the Great Commission, to go and to make disciples and to baptize people? How many have heard that sermon before? It's a really nice, tidy sermon, right? The only problem is it's not true. All right? There's actually one command only. This is coming to what's so great about the Great Commission. All right? I haven't forgot that. We're building toward that. There's only one command in the Great Commission. The one command you have is to make disciples. That's it. When you look at the verbiage of the Greek in there, the one imperative, which means you do this and you keep doing it, and do it 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 some more, is make disciples. The word go is actually in the imperfect, and it's a participle, and the word make the word baptize them is the same thing. It's a participle, imperfect. And so what they do is they, in the Greek language, then they modify the active verb, which is to make disciples. In other words, one's telling you how to do it, and the other one's telling you when to do it, and the other's telling you how to do what you're supposed to be doing. You're supposed to be making disciples. Here, let me put it this way. A really good translation of go, therefore, would be as you're going. As you're going. Why? Because everybody goes. Right? Everybody, you're going to be going tomorrow somewhere. You're going to go to work. You're going to go shopping. You're going to do something. You're going somewhere. You're doing something. I'm going to be going tomorrow. Where everybody's going to be going somewhere. Could be work. Could be recreation. It could be pleasure. It could be a thousand things that they're doing. But everybody is going. This is when you make disciples. As you're going in your normal everyday life, this is when we're supposed to be making disciples. Is as you're going, where are you going to be going tomorrow? That's when you should be making disciples. Making disciples is the one command in the whole thing. It's the imperative to do it and keep doing it. And then he says, and this is how you do it. You baptize them and you, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and then you teach them all the things that I have commanded you. You teach them to do it. This is how you're to do that. So this is when you're to do it and how you're to do it. You go and then you baptize is how you to do it. You're teaching them to do one thing. Make disciples. Just one thing. He's got started out with 12. He's down to 11. And now he's saying, each of you, make your own disciples. Make disciples. Not of you, but of me. As you're going. You know what you get on the top of a mountain? You know what you get there? A really scenic view of where you're eventually going to be going. Because nobody stays. No one stays on the mountaintop. Have you ever been out to the Smoky Mountains and you've gone up the Blue Ridge Parkway and you have those scenic overlooks? And then you get to the overlooks and what do? You stop, you pull over, you go, oh, isn't that beautiful? And you look down and there's a little town or there's whatever, there's a little village and there's whatever there is below you. Eventually, you're going down. You don't live there on the top. You're going down. And what you get at the top is a really good view, of just a spectacular scenic view of where you're going to go. I think that's why Jesus brought him there. I think that's part of why he said, you got to walk 5 days to get this command. Because this isn't the command of go into all the world. This is just the command as you're going. The other one's going to come later, you know, that you're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the other part. That's later. This is just as you're going. As you're going tomorrow, in your normal everyday going, make disciples. Wherever you're going, make disciples. And so he brings them home. Is what he's doing. He's bringing them home. This is where they're from. Peter and Andrew haven't even sold their fishing business yet. They're going to get up there and Peter's going to go, well, I'm going fishing. Why? Because he's still got the boat and the nets. And they're all going to, then James and John, who were in business with him, they still have the boats and the nets. They haven't sold all of that stuff. They've still got access to with the stuff. This is where this market, you know, some of them are from Phillips, from Bethesda, right across from there. It's Bethsaida. These guys are from this area. And so he brings them home. It's another reason I think they're on the mountain where they were where they used to go all the time, right on the backside of Capernaum, that headquarters for ministry, and they would go up there. It's another reason why I think he brought them here. He brings them up to the top of that mountain, and what do they see? They see their homes. They see their families. They see their businesses and they see their friends' homes and they see the bustle of Capernaum and then there's Tyrus and then there's Bethsaida across. And you can see it all from up on top of that mountain behind Capernaum on a clear day. You can see all the way across and see all the different cities. This is where they had lived. This is where they had grown up. And this is where Jesus takes them, and they have this scenic view of life as they've known it for so long. And Jesus says, as you're going, make some disciples the same way I made you. As you're going. Where are we going? Well, you're not staying up here. There's only one place to go, back down where you're from. Back down there. And they're eventually going to get back to Jerusalem, sure. But right now, he's showing them some, just an intimate time of just being with them and looking out. This is where it all started. This is where he called them. This is where they first heard the words, follow me. This is where they first set down the nets and began to follow him. This is where it all started, right here in this place. And Jesus has them look out. This is where they got their first set of marching orders, following him. And this is where they're going to get their second set. Now, as you're going, make disciples. I think that's really what's happening, why he brings them back here and why he doesn't just meet them in Jerusalem and say, I got a mission for you. There'll be more added on later, but right now, can you reach your own homes? Can you reach your own communities? Can you reach the guys that you grew up with, that you went to synagogue with, that you went to school with, that you, the friends that you still have, can you reach them? There's going to come a time to go across the whole world, but right now, can you reach your community? And there's no better place to get a view of the entire community than the mountain right out back. Right out back and takes them up on that mountain. Let me give you three easy steps to make a disciple. It's really not that hard. And by steps, I mean years. Because Jesus took 3 years to make these disciples. And so I should have rephrased that. Let me, how to make a disciple in 3 years. Easy years, what it, you get what I'm saying. So number one here, I'm going to go through these really quick. Number one, do it just exactly the way Jesus did, because he's not saying doing anything special. What he's saying is as you go. That's the command, right? That's the instructions. As you go, make disciples in the same way we do it. So number one, develop a relationship. That's exactly what he did with each of the disciples. Is all he did was say, hey, I want to have a relationship with you. You want to follow me? I'm the new rabbi in town. Paraphrased a bit, but that's essentially what he said is nobody knew him. He was the new rabbi in town when he set up shop in Capernaum. He was from Nazareth, right south of Capernaum. And so they didn't know him. And so he comes up and they're fishermen. He was a day laborer. He was a mason, a stonemason. Those paths didn't cross that often. Very likely they did not know him. And he comes up and says, I'm the new rabbi in town. Would you like to follow me? Peter took some convincing. There's actually 3 calls, but some of them just said, yes, I'd love to do anything but fish on this sea anymore. And so whatever it took, but they followed him. He developed a relationship. You know, that's one of the things we miss sometimes is just being a friend. to somebody else. Just the person at work or in the community or the neighbor or the family member who's everybody's always mad at her, or whoever it is that's always alone, and just develop a relationship. That's exactly what Jesus did. Is all he did was went and picked some guys and said, you wanna hang out with me? You wanna follow me? The next thing that he did, here's number two, model the behavior that you're desiring to get from them. See, Jesus didn't teach one thing and then do another thing. And we get fouled up in that sometimes, don't we? And that's why the church has this bad rap of hypocrites and blah, 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 and all of that kind of stuff. It's modeling the behavior that you desire to build into the people that you're developing a relationship. And so that basically comes down to walk the talk and talk the walk, right? Be who you say you want them to be. You be that person first. And Jesus was that in every sense of the term, and he did it perfectly. We're not going to do it perfectly, but listen, we need to put our best foot forward, and we need to develop relationships with the people around us in that community as we get up a little bit higher and we look over, and Jesus is saying, as you're going in your normal everyday life, make disciples, make a friend, and then model the behavior desired. And then number three, most important, lots of love and patience, because there's going to be mess ups along the way. Lots of love and lots of patience with them. How many times did he have to look at the disciples and say, seriously? Really? You don't get it yet? And yet, he's so loving and so patient. And he says, you know, I knew I should. You never see a point in the Gospels where Jesus looks at them and says, if y'all ain't a ragged bunch, I could have picked better in a marketplace blindfolded. I mean, but he never does that, does he? It's love and patience. Love and patience, love and patience, over and over again. He just is loving to them, and when they mess up, he's patient with them. That's the three steps. Develop a relationship, model the behavior, and have lots of love and patience. That's why Paul could say in 1 Corinthians 11:1, follow me as I follow Christ. He's developed a relationship. He's modeling the behavior, follow me as I follow Christ. He's modeling the behavior, and he just loves them. That's the whole point of it. In other words, where you normally go on Monday, you develop relationships with those people. And then you model what following Jesus looks like while inviting them to join you, and you love those people. That's the secret sauce. It's the secret recipe that Jesus used with the disciples. And see, I started out with what's so great about the Great Commission. That's what's so great. Anybody can do it. It doesn't take an apostle. It takes people. Other people following Jesus. Other people who are disciples. That's all it takes. Anybody can make disciples. Anybody can follow the Great Commission. Anybody can do what he said. What's so great about it is anybody can do it. And the only question left then is, will you do it? That's the only question left. Is will you have the courage to develop those relationships? Will you have the discipline to model that behavior on a consistent basis? And will you have the heart that will love those people who will say, yeah, I'll join you. You've touched me, and I'll join you. Every Sunday morning, we've been seeing these videos, and what's there? And they bring somebody on to tell about their testimony. And it's always this. Somebody reaches out. Somebody develops a relationship. Somebody models. And love and patience. That's the secret sauce. It has been since he picked the 12 disciples. It continues to be so today. The Great Commission is great because anybody can do it. You don't have to have a master's degree. You don't have to memorize the Torah. You don't have to do any. Listen, all you got to do is love God, love people. Anybody can do it. And so let me ask you this as we close. Where are you going tomorrow? You can consider this the mountaintop, right? This is where you get the vision. This is where you look out. This is where God speaks to you. This is the mountaintop. Because you're not staying here. We're turning out the lights. And we're locking the door. It's like a friend of mine at work says at 3:30, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. Right? And so, same thing here. At some point tonight, we're going to turn out the lights, lock the door, and you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. And so, this is you consider this your mountaintop here, because you're going to be going somewhere. As you're going to be going tonight. And you're going to be going tomorrow. You're going to be going somewhere probably multiple times tomorrow. It's not just a hit and miss, one-shot deal. There's several places that maybe you have to go tomorrow. Maybe there's somebody, maybe there's several people that you can develop a relationship just by talking to them. Where are you going tomorrow? What kind of life are you going to model tomorrow? What kind of life are you going to model tomorrow? For those people to see? That's a huge question, because it's a choice, right? That's part of a choice that you're going to have to make. And you can say what you're going to do today, but tomorrow is when you make the choice. Tomorrow, when the coffee spills is when you're going to make the choice, right? Tomorrow, when that hot cup of coffee dumps on your lap, that's when you make the choice, right? Tomorrow, when the hammer goes in exactly the wrong spot, there's a choice. I'll never forget a guy who worked out on the F4s out on Cherry Point. He worked with Dad. Dad probably doesn't even know this story. And Dad was out there on an F4 working, and this guy was working with him. And Dad did something, but he cut his hand. He did something to his hand, or bashed it or something. Every other guy on that line would have been fluent in the most flowery language, I'm sure, known to the military. And that guy was watching Dad because he knew he was a preacher. Dad had been developing a relationship with him. Him and his wife owned a Japanese restaurant right outside of Cherry Point. You know who I'm talking about now. And he was watching him that day. And when that accident happened with his hand, he said that man didn't grimace, he didn't swear, he didn't yell, he didn't holler. To the best of his recollection, he said, "Praise the Lord." And he started coming to church. Because they've been developing a relationship. And because he could see that he was modeling the behavior and the way that he just loved him. Where are you going to be going tomorrow? What kind of life are you going to model? And can you love those people? Let's pray. Father, thank you for taking us to this mountain. Thank you for the fact that you made the Great Commission, this great, great commission, in such a way that